These awards are given, as you know, at commencement. And we recognize the honorees for their superb skills, but also their achievements in their fields and their dedication to this university and to all of our students. And if you weren't at commencement and you didn't know, we had four winners this year. Provost, we had four winners this year instead of three. Yes. And the provost told me what I already knew. He said it was because the faculty is just that good. Now, that doesn't mean we're going to change it to a four every year, does it? Okay. All right. Oh, each of our honored professors will present this afternoon on the topic of their choice. Uniting their presentations this year is the theme of building the University of Massachusetts, Boston, : the pursuit of excellence. I greatly appreciate the wording of this theme. The word building implies that we are in continuous motion, which we are, and the word pursuit implies that excellence is a moving target, and so we're constantly chasing it. And as we grow and we build, the heights of excellence will grow with us, and I'm so grateful for that. Consider our four winners. They didn't accept their awards for distinguished teaching, scholarship, and service, and then go home and stop trying. Stephanie, Joan, Rachel, and John are highly talented and accomplished teachers, scholars, and leaders who are still in pursuit of more. Stephanie is still blowing minds in the classroom. Joan is still finding opportunities to serve our university, even though she told me she was at least going to take a break, still serving and serving and serving, and to train those in our community to serve others. Rachel just published an awesome, awesome new book on the subculture of Renaissance fairs, and John is editing yet another volume of Shakespeare, this time with the prestigious Arden editions. They are chasing down excellence, and I'm so excited to hear the details and to learn from them this afternoon. But before we get started, I'd like to take a moment to thank Daniel Ortiz, who is the Dean of University Libraries, for sort of taking this over when George sort of went northwest on us, and for bringing the same level of thought and attention to detail to this event. And I was kind of worried when he called and said he was leaving. I know it left some room for in the library that you needed to fill and all that, but I was more concerned about the two major events that he was doing for my office. I'm sorry. But now you've stepped up, and so listen, man, thank you. I really do appreciate it. I also like to thank our committee members, those who helped select the winners for the Chancellor's Award for Distinguished Teaching, Scholarship, and Service. As always, they faced a real challenge this year, going through nominations and also picking the winners. It's not an easy task when we have so many faculty members, many of whom let me know that they have qualified and should be selected. And I can always say, look, there's a nominating group, and those winners this year, I believe, Provost, will join that group to make sure that you help select the future winners. So I appreciate your good judgment and your commitment. Finally, thank you all for coming in the middle of your day. I'm so grateful to have all four of our award winners here today and many of our amazing faculty here to join us as well. It means a lot to me to see you all here to support your colleagues and your friends. This spirit of support and this spirit of solidarity is what faculty members tell me they love about being here at this university. And so let's keep it going. Thank you. Now, I have the honor of bringing the provost forward to introduce the session. And so, without further ado, our provost, Winston Langley.
Well, my task is a rather modest one, which is to introduce the first presenter to us this afternoon, but I simply want to say that I'm particularly pleased that this event is taking place at this time, because in part, over the past few months, we have been hearing about MOOCs and the what is considered the danger that is posed to the traditional university, including the research university. And sometimes I think we have to remind ourselves that the education provided by the university has its own unique features that are not easily replicated elsewhere. So we may be talking about a different form of education. But it bespeaks many things, among them the manifold academic activity that takes place within what is called a university, or the variety of modes of inquiry that forms the culture of that university, and how they together constitute a form of conversation in which I think we'll be engaging this this afternoon. And it therefore gives me particular pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Joan Liem, who, as you know, has been with us for a number of years, ably led our distinguished program in clinical psychology, led our graduate studies office, is now responsible for most of the doctoral programs that we have had recently approved by the Board of Trustees, with our inimitable way of ensuring that they be properly prepared, and is the embodiment of what we consider to be the person within the academy who sees public service as having something of a noble character.
Good afternoon. It's really nice to see so many familiar faces. As the winner of the Chancellor's Medal for Distinguished Service, I've been asked to focus on the role of service in building the University of Massachusetts Boston. Ernest Linton, writing about the scholarship of engagement, noted that, quote, "Professional service can constitute scholarship of the highest order, equivalent in intellectual challenge, creativity, and importance to scholarly research and scholarly teaching." Close quote. At its best, professional service is the application of one's scholarship and the extension of one's teaching beyond the classroom. I'm going to talk about what it's meant for me to be involved in that kind of service by focusing on several examples of service activities that have played a significant role in shaping UMass Boston and have most certainly shaped my career during my 40 years in residence. Of course, trying to cover 40 years in a 10-minute talk is a daunting task. Let me put my time frame at UMass Boston into perspective. When I first arrived in 1972, the United States was about to elect Richard Nixon, was about to re-elect Richard Nixon as president. That year, he became the first U.S. president to visit China, an accomplishment that had to be shared in the headlines with the Watergate scandal that was fast unfolding. Women were just starting to be admitted to previously all-male colleges and allowed for the first time to join the FBI and run in the Boston Marathon. Congress passed the Equal Employment Opportunity Act to address discrimination in the workplace, and much controversy swirled around the decision to remove homosexuality from the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic Manual of Mental Disorders, an action that wasn't fully completed until 1986. Now fast forward to 2012, We've just re-elected the first black president of the United States, and Massachusetts has elected its first woman to the United States Senate. We've approved same-sex marriage in 8 states and have recognized some form of civil unions in 6 others. Women are suing the Pentagon to end their exclusion from combat duty and combat pay. And while we're still dealing with discrimination in the workplace, a lot has changed in the United States, and a lot has changed at UMass Boston as well. So let me begin my story with an early service activity that's left a lasting impression on me. When I first arrived in 1972, there were 2 colleges of arts and sciences, aptly, if not creatively, named College 1 and College 2. The original plan for UMass Boston called for 6 such colleges, each with several thousand students. The idea was to couple the intimacy of small liberal arts colleges with the dynamism of a large public research university. It fairly quickly became clear, however, that multiple liberal arts colleges were going to be too costly administratively and would prohibit the development of other colleges and professional schools. Shortly after moving to the Harbor campus, the decision was made to consolidate Colleges 1 and 2 into one College of Arts and Sciences. I was asked to serve as the junior faculty representative on the Unification Committee, a committee otherwise composed of senior faculty from the 2 colleges. As you might imagine, there was resistance to unifying 2 colleges that had each been developed with distinctive identities and had hired faculty and recruited students accordingly. I don't know why I was invited to serve on the Unification Committee, and in hindsight, realized that a wiser junior faculty member might have declined the invitation. But service on the committee proved to be an invaluable education in university politics and the role of faculty in university decision-making. It taught me that serious committee work requires skills not unlike those necessary when conducting good research. To be influential required gathering relevant data and making recommendations that were supported by sound logic and strong empirical evidence. Interviewing stakeholders and studying college consolidations at other universities introduced me to talented colleagues outside my own department and to perspectives on the university from many disciplinary vantage points. It broadened my perspective on the institution and diminished my disciplinary chauvinism. The Unification Committee helped guide the integration of academic departments and shaped the new College of Arts and Sciences. The university redirected its energy toward establishing a number of other colleges, some of which also had to overcome resistance, but all of which have contributed to making UMass Boston the comprehensive university it is today. Soon after being tenured, I was asked to join the provost's office as an associate provost and to serve as well as director of graduate studies. At the time, UMass had only 1 PhD program and a handful of master's programs, so serving both as associate provost and director of graduate studies seemed manageable. The very day I joined the provost's office, however, Chancellor Robert Corrigan held an emergency meeting of the senior staff at which he informed us that the Massachusetts legislature was merging UMass Boston and Boston State College. Because of Bob Corrigan's able leadership, UMass Boston won the right to review the faculty and programs at Boston State and determine which ones to absorb into UMass Boston, thus protecting all of our own faculty and programs. Boston State had about 24 master's programs all run through continuing education, and I was charged with overseeing the review of every one of them. By the end of my term as associate provost, UMass Boston had acquired a College of Nursing and a College of Education and had moved most of the Boston State master's programs out of continuing education and into academic departments. The merger of Boston State College and UMass Boston represented interference of the highest order by the Massachusetts legislature, but it also challenged campus leaders to think creatively and work diligently to preserve the very best that both institutions had to offer. The merger with Boston State taught me the critical importance of strong leadership and strategic planning in building excellence at UMass Boston. After 2 years in the provost's office, the psychology department asked me to come back and serve as chairperson, and I was ready for a change. My merger-defined role as associate provost allowed too little time for my five-year-old twins, my students, and my scholarship, and I felt ready and better prepared to finish work I had started before joining the provost's office on the clinical psychology graduate program. Working together with colleagues in psychology, I designed, secured approval for, hired the first director, helped implement, and later for 12 years directed the doctoral program in clinical psychology. Now 23 years old, the clinical program has been enormously successful. It has attracted first-rate faculty and students and has produced graduates whose scholarship addresses critical social problems in ways that fit well with Ernest Linton's notion of engaged scholarship. My participation in its creation and its development has been my most significant professional service and my most direct contribution to furthering excellence at UMass Boston. The clinical program provides students with the research and clinical skills needed to engage in culturally and developmentally competent research and practice, and fosters a commitment in its graduates to provide effective services to underserved populations, especially urban communities of color. It has enjoyed great success in launching the careers of over 125 PhDs, who now occupy faculty, research, and clinical positions across the country. What makes the clinical psychology graduate program truly outstanding is the quality of its faculty. Over the years, I chaired or served on the search committees for all except the most recent core faculty, and I take great pride in having played a role in bringing so many outstanding faculty members to this university. In 2007, the clinical program was ranked one of the top 10 clinical programs in the country, based on an index of faculty productivity developed by Academic Analytics. While I can't claim credit for the productivity of my colleagues, I do take pride in the role I played in bringing them to UMass and in helping to create an environment within the department that's been nurturing of their talents and supportive of their productivity. The quality of a graduate program also depends on the quality of its students. The clinical program admits 8 to 10 students a year from among 300 to 350 applicants. This makes it the most selective program on campus. In spite of the relatively modest nature of our stipends and the high cost of living in Boston, we are able to attract truly outstanding students because of the quality of the faculty, the clear articulation of our mission, and the high quality of our research and clinical training. And the success of placing students in highly competitive practicum placements, internships, postdocs, and jobs. Approximately one-third of the students we admit, educate, and graduate are students of color. Because of our consistent record in attracting these students and because of the quality of their work, our program was awarded the American Psychological Association's Minority Achievement Award. There are few other clinical programs in the country that have produced the number of ethnic minority PhDs that our program has produced. The program has also been exceptionally successful in helping its ethnic minority students secure APA minority fellowships to support their graduate education. These fellowships, which require extensive faculty mentoring, provide students with 1 to 3 years of full-time support. With close faculty mentoring, our students have also done amazingly well in securing other sources of funding for their research. National Institute of Health grants, National Research Service Awards, National Alliance for Autism Research Awards, and others. Supporting graduate students with teaching and research assistantships is an essential requirement of a well-functioning doctoral program, and I'm proud that we've found the means to support all of our students from a mixture of university and external sources, and have prepared them well to compete successfully for externally funded internships and grants that support their dissertation research. The clinical program requires both a master's thesis and a doctoral dissertation, as well as 2 years of full-time supervised clinical practice at 2 different practicum sites, and a full-year full-time clinical internship for which students compete nationally. Thus, a great deal of faculty time is spent outside the classroom, engaged in one-on-one research and clinical supervision. I'm very proud of the research mentorship that I've provided my own doctoral students and the journal articles and conference presentations I've co-authored with them. Close faculty research mentorship of graduate students is standard practice in the clinical program. I've also enjoyed enormously providing one-on-one clinical supervision to our students doing their practicum at the University Counseling Center and co-authoring articles about that work with colleagues and with graduate students. Because of the close and careful clinical mentoring our students receive, the clinical program places 96% of its students in APA-approved paid clinical internships. This is one of the highest match rates of any clinical program in the country and a critical indicator of the success of the program. The vigorous engagement of faculty with students inside and outside the classroom is another prime example of what is involved in creating excellence at UMass Boston. In 2008, I was asked by Provost Langley to serve as graduate dean. I hope that my leadership as dean has also contributed to furthering UMass Boston's pursuit of excellence and has enhanced its reputation as a graduate institution. As dean, I've worked to strengthen existing graduate programs and develop new ones. I advocated for and secured increased stipend support for graduate students, worked with graduate admissions to improve our admissions processes, and with the staff of the Office of Graduate Studies to provide more and better services to students and to faculty. I also restructured the monthly meetings of graduate program directors in an effort to provide increased support to enable them to do their jobs more effectively. One accomplishment of which I feel especially proud is the creation of 3 distinguished mentoring awards for faculty and professional staff who've provided outstanding mentoring for graduate students. A great deal of work that goes on with graduate students occurs outside the classroom, and this work needs to be better recognized and rewarded. And I was pleased to present the first ever Distinguished Mentoring Awards at the graduate convocation last May. I was surprised and delighted when Provost Winston Langley and Vice Provost Zhang Guozha decided to name those mentoring awards in my honor. UMass Boston's excellence is secured by the fine work of faculty and staff, such as the individuals recognized by these awards, and I will be forever grateful to have my name associated with them. Since retiring as dean, I've been serving as the special assistant to the provost for new graduate program development. Continuing to build new academic programs is essential to the campus's pursuit of excellence, and work that I find enormously rewarding. The university is greatly strengthened by those faculty members who invest their energies in developing and implementing new graduate programs. These programs offer our increasingly diverse student body a broader array of academic opportunities, and it is my privilege to play a small continuing role in helping program developers further UMass Boston's development as a public research university whose pursuit of excellence includes professional service as a form of engaged scholarship. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. And now it is my great privilege to introduce another engaged scholar, Stephanie Hartwell, who is this year's winner of the Chancellor's Award for Distinguished Teaching. Steffi is an incredibly energetic individual. She is one of the most energetic individuals I know. She has been a wonderful graduate program director to the master's students in applied sociology. She has developed an incredible array of partnerships off campus that enable those students to do research together with her on projects that are very meaningful to their careers. And she has been a fabulous classroom teacher and a wonderful and instrumental writer, together with Russell Shoot, of the new PhD program in sociology, and will be its first director. So, or maybe not. And so I am I am very, very happy to introduce Steffi Hartwell.
Jeez. So to come up and talk about teaching, then distinction in teaching is a pretty hard thing to do. I did borrow a colleague's book, What the Best College Professors Do, and sat there for a long time. Then I started to look through it, and I was, geez, I don't do any of this. So then I started to think I'd have to come sort of talk about my philosophy of teaching. So I have some slides. I sort of blame the chancellor for why I'm here today. I'd like to thank the nominating committee. So I'm aware of the honor that receiving the teaching award, an honor signified by this campus's historical commitment to teaching. It's an honor that has inspired me to do better. I know this might be hard to believe, but I did not start out in pursuit of excellence, and being perfect is not my thing. My mother was the first to recognize I was trouble and maybe even had a little bit of an attitude problem. My students are my inspiration, and also they're my relief. Students who always strive to do better, who laugh, who are all managing life as it races and ravages along. But there has also been my mother. She's a teacher, or was a teacher by day, and a nurse by night. She was my phys ed teacher, equal parts kicking me off the field for being unsportsmanlike, and at home telling me I could be anything I believed in after she sent me to the principal that day. She believed in educating her daughters in the broadest and most deliberate manner. She was the only person who ever sent me to the principal and called the cops on me. Today, she laughs about it and reminds me, you deserved it. She was correct, but she also believed in me and thought I was something else. When I teach, I love to tell stories. My head is full of stories. My favorite stories as a kid were like Nancy Drew with a strong female lead. I also love Dr. Seuss. Yertle the Turtle is a favorite. It's a strong story of class inequality. It's social justice. It was recently banned out of school in British Columbia for being too political. And tales of misfits who overcame the odds. Recently, I read Tales of a Fourth Grade Nothing to my girls. We could relate to the theme of siblings and the inherent conflicts of the assault waged on the older sibling by the younger sibling. Being a younger sibling, I related to the younger sibling, whose name is Fudgy. And Fudgy is great until the end of the book when he eats his older brother Peter's miniature turtle. So the miniature turtle sort of stuck with me when I was a kid, and also I was reminded of it when I read the story to my daughters recently. Although Fudgy passed the turtle eventually, and Peter got a puppy, I wondered when I was a kid, and I sort of had flashbacks because my daughters didn't get why I was so upset. Like, the dribble, like what happened to dribble? Where's the social justice for dribble? The turtle, the suffering turtle that was eaten. I had a research agenda at a very young age. I was going to save the world. There are so many first-year graduate students that come into my introductory graduate class and say to me, I want to save the world, because they're not sure what else to say, I think, in some regards. But sociologists in applied sociology, that's how they start out. As Dr. Seuss wrote in Yertle the Turtle, he wrote, I know on the top you're seeing great sights, but down on the bottom, we too have rights. And you would think that I'd be teaching more about that because my research agenda is in social justice. But when I teach, I don't focus on that part of the story. I focus on this part where this small little turtle named Mac at the bottom of the pile burps and all hell breaks loose. Yes, my students study human rights and plights, but what they learn from my research agenda is nothing is perfect, everything is political. Small acts of humanity shape large-scale social policy. My research agenda looks remarkably turtle-shaped, and it's sort of a perfect fit for what I do. I have invest my energy in trying to find grant money to support social justice programming for vulnerable populations, and I found that the sky's the limit here for public service with a social justice mission. And so my fit at UMass Boston has been perfect. Still, as I mentioned earlier, perfection is rare, but excellence is an attitude. I learned a long time ago, instead of waiting for things to be perfect, you have to decide to love the things that are not. So I have my exhibits here. Nothing is perfect. Take my cat, Sam. He is beautiful and cute, but he occasionally tries to take down a fox in the backyard. And he also occasionally poops in our bathtub when we have more than five people in the house. We are a family of four. He's actually really gentle. He purrs a lot. He comes in each night at dusk. He loves us. He is excellent, but not perfect. Exhibit B is my dog, Coca. Now, this sweet dog graduated agility school 2 times. For a dog, that's like getting an MD, PhD at Yale. She still slinks away, does not come when she's called. She is Coca. She is perfect, but she is not perfect, but she is excellent and hilarious. Throw her into a room, a bunch of 5 to 8 year olds. She is sweet, she is safe, and she cleans the floor. She is also highly motivated by Toast. They remind me that things can never be perfect, but like UMass Boston, you can love them anyway. And there is the potential for excellence. When I first started teaching at UMass Boston, I taught in a large lecture hall in Snowden Auditorium. This is the renewed sort of Snowden, and that is not my class, because I'm concerned about the guy sleeping in the middle. Very concerned. I used to teach this sort of, there were reels of film, and you had to put the reel in, and it never really worked, and I was a first-year teacher, and you really, that day, you really wanted the movie to work, because you weren't used to actually having to have a backup lesson. And then in the auditorium, there was a stage, and on the stage was a chalkboard. And one day I was using the chalkboard, and I'm not kidding, it bounced on the stage and then fell down into my students in the front row. And I thought, oh, this is it. So I went to the dean at the time, and I said, I don't want to teach in this room anymore. I can't make the projector work. And the chalkboard fell on my students. And the dean at the time was Neil Bruss. And he, like so many deans, eloquently and classily said to me, all right, we're going to fix this. We'll make it better. The next week, in my box, I got a nicely hand-typed note from the dean asking me to please join the committee to refurbish Snowden Auditorium. That was a lesson. I quickly realized, yes, we could do better, and that UMass Boston was a fixer-upper. Committed to social justice, yes, but needing some help and attention. It has been wonderful to see it all grow, from the dingy garages to the beautiful campus center, a football team with 8 players we had to let go, to division championships or close to it in volleyball, women's soccer, baseball. But nearest and dearest, of course, to my heart is graduate programming on campus. The highs and lows of graduate programming and graduate students. There's some GPDs in the room. They understand this. They keep you current and young. Students that work all day and come to class almost till 10 at night. Students that work hand in hand with us on our research projects, run service projects, intern in the community. Students that take advantage of all the opportunities on campus, whether it's volunteering on campus. I had a graduate student this semester who actually did that Operation Shield thing with the state police here. I thought that was awesome. Running bingos at homeless shelters and volunteering at prison books. Students that are veterans making the adjustment from enlistment to the classroom. Graduate students are our best ambassadors and resources, and for that reason, it is my job to see the potential in each and every one. Graduate students are not perfect, but they are excellent. I've also been a working mom, and as the other women on the panel are, on a personal note, I so appreciate that my kids know what I do, what mom does, is something they believe is of significance, that I believe is of significance. Get a little shaken up when I talk about them. They are huge UMass Boston fans. In the second one, they both have their little sweatshirts. So they refuse to dress alike, so one threw one on the ground. They love to come to the office. We take our bikes and we ride from UMass Boston to Castle Island. We had season tickets to UMass football this year, and as their attention to games faltered, my oldest complained to me, it isn't even our UMass. They are growing up traveling, seeing great sights, and with the benefits of a campus, which we all know isn't perfect, but they seem to think it's an excellent place for adventures. Graduate students approach UMass Boston the same way, and we all should too. So I treasure UMass Boston for all these reasons: the emphasis on excellent, empathetic teaching, the social justice mission, the support of research and creativity, the willingness to always try to do better, and the growth of graduate students and programming. UMass Boston isn't perfect, but I've never known an institution that has more potential and is in the business of maximizing potential. I love that I teach about what I do and can always try new things. I even have a Twitter account. I have 9 followers. 9. They are all my grad students, and they count a lot. I've been at UMass Boston for 15 years, and I've never heard once, you cannot do that. And over the years, I've done some crazy things in the classroom and with the students. But those are stories for another day. UMass Boston isn't perfect, but it's an excellent place to be a sociology professor. Who's not standing up? Thanks. With that, it is my pleasure to introduce Professor John Tobin, who I think would agree this is an excellent place to be a professor. Meeting Professor Tobin and listening to Professor Tobin has been a great perk of being trotted out to these events. Professor Tobin won the Chancellor's Award for Distinguished Teaching along with Professor Rubin. He is a very, very nice man and someone I would not hesitate to seek out for advice on any front. And I have a lot of chaotic fronts, so that's saying something.
Thank you, Stephanie. I'm honored to be part of this quartet, and I want to thank the Personnel Committee of the English Department for nominating me in the first place, particularly Sean O'Connell and Betsy Clymer Smith, and the younger and brilliant Shakespearean in the department, Scott Maizano. I'd also like to thank Alice Carter, the head of the committee that chose this year's honorees. The Chancellor talked a little bit about the elegance of the phrase, pursuit of excellence. And I'm reminded that the greatest non-dramatic poem in the time of Shakespeare is Spenser's The Faerie Queen, which is about a number of knights, mostly men, but the best of them is a woman, all of whom are in pursuit of excellence. And they never quite get the hang of it, but they don't stop. So I didn't know whether the Chancellor was reading The Faerie Queen recently, or it was a case of great minds yet again meeting. But I'd like to say that for me, etymology is a category of thought, and I was thinking of the etymology of excellence, and there is a way to go about superiority and dominance, which we never do reach. But there is a basic meaning of the word. The two words, the preposition ex, out of or from, and celera, meaning to rise. And I think by the time I finish, you may realize the justice of applying excellence, rising out of, as applied to the University of Massachusetts at Boston. I'd like to say a few words about a paradox between the challenge of promising or promoting scholarship and the importance of making it real through teaching. In my world of scholarship, I focus in particular on Shakespeare's sources, his texts, and they're multiple, that is, multiple of individual texts, and the performance history of the plays, all of which become part of the discussion in class, along with Hamlet and Othello and Prospero and Cleopatra. Here at UMB, we are a research university that values teaching fully as much as scholarship. Scholars believe, I think they have to believe, that what they're doing is important, even very important, and maybe even all important if they think that what they're studying is a sacred text, Hamlet, Lear, Othello, and the sonnets of Shakespeare. But teachers of literature have to also be in the business of disabusing students of the idea that Shakespeare or any other prominent author is so rarefied, so special, so much a genius that he's mysterious, intimidating, and out of reach. Well, Shakespeare, for example, was a genius, but he was not an ivory tower, unreachable poet. He was, in fact, a young man from the provinces who made good coming to the big city of London. He was a person who thought about life and its complexities and expressed himself in language that we cannot match. But the thoughts are about issues that we have felt about, thought about, perhaps, alas, inarticulately, but he is us. Our challenge and our opportunity at UMB is to resolve this paradox of scholarly commitment to the unique and the mysterious, and to the pedagogical revelation that what at one moment seems unique and mysterious is really quite intelligible and indeed profoundly common, thereby giving our students the opportunity to think, write, and create both their own sense of self and what their future will be. I'm not a founding faculty member of UMB, but as a son of Boston, I feel a particular kinship with the origins of this university, its particular location, and its bright future. I grew up in Roxbury and Mattapan, neighborhoods sometimes forgotten in descriptions and coverage of this city. And this university, as some of you may know, was built on a part of the city left as of very limited use. It was a landfill, a garbage pile. Now, almost 50 years later, UMB, and almost 40 years later, in its rebirth here at Columbia Point, it is a central focus of the city's innovative success and progressive future. Now, Boston is still referred to as the Athens of America. I don't know whether you saw a poll run by some group published this morning, on NPR at least, the most intellectual city in North America. Number 4, Vancouver. Number 3, Seattle. Number 2, San Francisco. Number 1, Boston. So, yes, you can still call this the Athens of America, even though Athens and Boston itself have changed greatly from the first time the comparison was made. Boston's success, like that of its analog, is based not just on technological progress and grand political and legal traditions, but also on its long-standing commitment to arts and letters. As an English professor teaching Shakespeare and Chaucer and Milton, I spent a great deal of time thinking about how to make literature of those early days clear to our students. And also to make clear the relevance of those texts to our current students. And a great deal of the time, I worry about the hit the humanities have taken in popular discourse about higher education. My response, perhaps unsurprisingly, is that as we look ahead to UMB's future and the contributions it and its students and faculty will make, the role of the humanities, and particularly literature, is central to the work we all do, regardless of our field and of our ultimate goals. The privilege of teaching Shakespeare is a reminder every day of the democratic appeal of both the playwright and literature in general, that we come together and share our ideas, our interpretations, and our understandings in a way that illuminates our own worlds and each other's as larger and richer than we had previously understood. We have just had an election where it became clear, if it had not already been very clear, that we face very serious problems in this country. And time after time, this president and presidents before him, even before Lincoln, who was so steeped in Shakespeare, these presidents have relied on art and literature to remind us of the big ideas and important principles that will help to guide us through the solution of such problems. We need inspiration. We sometimes need consolation. We certainly need bridges between and among ourselves, the many selves that lie within us. I've been fortunate here to receive sabbaticals and occasionally reduced course loads that have naturally enough greatly helped my scholarship. But it's possible that those helps would exist at any university that I might have taught at. What has made my scholarship truly possible has been the administration, my colleagues and my students. And I'd like to say all departments are equal, but as a wise man once said, some departments are more equal than others. And I'm fortunate to work in a department where the chairs and the recruitment committees over the years have brought to the university people of great knowledge, and perhaps more importantly, great character. The environment I work in is a gift. I might happily pay the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to let me do what it currently pays me to do, though perhaps I shouldn't say that to Chancellor Motley or Provost Langley. There's something special about working in a department where collegiality is genuine and universal, and working for a college where the administrators are talented and supportive. Of course, all English department professors are in their heart of hearts also Shakespeareans. And when I walk down the hall from my office to the copy machine, I walk by Neil Bruce, Vivian Zamel, Sean O'Connell, Lloyd Schwartz, John Hess, and on any given day, it could be a different quintet, all of whom have given me insights, support, and inspiration. My students every day see new things in Shakespeare and inspire my scholarly work. It's easy to believe that our students learn and develop their analytical skills through what we know and what we tell them, but it is equally true that our students see things in the text that we have not seen ourselves. A main focus in my scholarship is on textual cruces, difficult passages with problematic terms. Sometimes when I think I know exactly what a word or phrase means in Shakespeare, a student quite reasonably introduces a different interpretation, and suddenly everything has changed. This process of collaborative exploration and shared insight makes the class ever so much better, and it also makes the work of scholarship considerably better. But for UMB, the opportunity for our students to share the great mind of Shakespeare in these wonderful works would not exist. Without literature and interpretation, the creative spirit and generative spark of UMB would not exist. All of which brings me back to my opening point about the paradox between scholarship and teaching, genius that is so distant, and realities that are so proximate. Shakespeare was a genius, but he is approachable, real, and inspiring. UMB was built on a landfill, what was a garbage pile. It now rises on Columbia Point as a beacon of the promise of public higher education, and of the talent of our faculty, and of the alertness and drive of our students. When I teach Shakespeare with my students, I remind them that the first piece of information we have about Shakespeare's father, John Shakespeare, is that he was fined for having a midden on his property, that is, a rubbish or trash pile. I go on to point out that his eldest son, who as a boy doubtless played next to that trash heap or on the top of that rubbish pile, and he went on to become the greatest writer in the English-speaking world. We are lucky to teach here where we teach at UMB and to live where we live, still the Athens of America, where the commitment to learning, to arts and literature, and to political progress is as great as anywhere on the globe. Thank you. I am very pleased to be one of the two scholarship winners this year, and I feel I'm doing an injustice to Rachel, who deserves the chancellor or the provost to introduce her. I thought one or the other would do it, and all I can say is there are very few scholars not just at this university, but any university, that writes so well, thinks so deeply, and touches upon so many different subjects as Rachel Rubin. She has written on ever so many different aspects of American culture, from Jewish gangsters to jazz to the South, and a new book on the role of Elizabethan fairs, is that correct, in American counterculture? Close enough? Close enough. Well, fall upon the topos of inexpressibility. That is, words cannot do justice to this gifted scholar. Rachel.
All right, I'm just going to tip my hand up front. In American studies, we do not believe there is such a thing as excellence. I assume that you're all laughing over here because you get my joke. We don't believe there is such a thing as excellence. We do believe that there are excellences located in many places, manifesting in many ways, and making glorious messes out of any attempts at simplistic definitions or external measurements, or even sentences without a lot of dependent clauses and contextualizing parentheticals and hopefully footnotes. You've now learned something really fundamental about American studies and about me. Words do matter, even tiny little ones composed of one letter like the A I threw out just now. In fact, teaching and acknowledging the profound power wielded by words is truly an excellent academic goal. We all know what a moral, political, historical, and ideological throwdown it is to refer to another human being as illegal. In the face of that, I have been bowled over in my research for my current book to encounter this year as part of this new project a young visual artist named Julio Salgado, who refers to himself as undocuqueer. And it really means something different than saying I am undocumented and queer. You don't have to invent a whole new word either to encounter this kind of power. For instance, I love the Lynyrd Skynyrd song, What's Your Name, largely because of the way the singer draws out the word champagne, turning it into a sly commentary on the fanciness of champagne and his own working class subject position, and an acknowledgement that some people think the likes of him shouldn't be drinking champagne. It's all there just in the elongated first syllable. So given all that, you can imagine how various definitions of excellence are shouting on our campus, sometimes in unison, sometimes in harmony, sometimes in dissonance. So what, today's prompt asks us, are some of these locations? Well, at our American Studies fall reception, we went around the room and we had everybody, student and faculty, say what he or she thought makes a truly excellent class. I said that I thought an excellent class is when somebody sticks her or his head in from outside and says, would you mind keeping it down just a little in there? When I said that, I was not kidding. And it's not always because we are listening to the Ghetto Boys performing Damn It Feels Good to Be a Gangster either, though that indeed is a hallmark of a good education. It's that I think that successful intellectual activity is a boisterous conversation, one carried out with excitement and enthusiasm, and generally one in which people disagree. What I hope as a faculty member that I have learned from working my way through my various books and articles and other scholarship is how to use these scholarly endeavors to invite our students into that noisy conversation. How to give them the tools to say, yeah, but what if you think about it this way? Or aren't you forgetting about that extenuating circumstance? Or if you read this in Arabic, you'd understand it differently. Or the entirely crucial, prove it, which, by the way, in humanities research we call creating an attentive and reliable chain of historical evidence. Or even, that's wrong. Or even, that's wrong, Professor Rubin. So no, I don't think there is such a thing as excellence, but I do maintain that in a university setting, that conversation might come close. I also think it's truly excellent when students are able and willing to move from "you're reading too much into it" to "I have the ability to read what is in it." That might be the profoundest way to interact with the world, because you are both acknowledging and deploying your own empowerment through the interpretive act. If you don't do this, you're just sort of sitting there. So this latter development generally happens for me when we're talking about the music of Little Richard. I play Long Tall Sally for a class, and Long Tall Sally, in case you don't remember, is tall, bald, built for speed, ducks in and out of the alley, and so forth. And then I invite the students to talk about the saxophone break that happens in the middle of that song. I might use the word climactic. And then the students say, "You're reading too much into it." And I say, "Believe me, like I could never read half as much into it as that man went and put into it." And that's despite having a strongly metaphoric bent and a reasonably dirty mind. Both qualities that are important and serve a person well in taking on Little Richard's opus. But with a little pushing and a little sharing of the scholarly work I've tried to do that shows how popular culture functions as a speech act without words sometimes, and soon the students are talking volubly about race, erasure, and 1950s domesticization of sex and sexuality in this clip. And this is just a really short clip from The Girl Can't Help It, the 1956 movie.
Get your morning paper, ma'am?
No, thanks, Sonny. Can you tell me where I can find 341?
341? Second branch though, ma'am.
Thanks, Sonny.
Can't help it, the girl can't help it. Can't help it, the girl can't help it.
If she walks by, I mean folks get the boat.
Can't help it, the girl can't help it.
If she winks an eye, the red light turns to toes.
Can't help it, the girl can't help it.
If she got a lot of what they call the mold.
Can't help it, the girl can't help it.
The girl can't help it, she was born to please.
Can't help it, the girl can't help it.
If she's got a bigger maid to squeeze.
Can't help it, the girl can't help it.
Won't you kindly be aware, the girl can't help it.
The girl can't help it.
Okay, that is an excellent clip. You can't actually see Little Richard, because to make his blackness actually visible during all this milky frothing over would have been far too threatening on the 1956 racial landscape. And as for Jane Mansfield, you know, right after the music stops, you learn all she wants to do really is cook and clean and so forth. So, a definition of excellence. When students stop thinking that being analytical ruins the fun and move toward thinking that it introduces a whole new kind of fun. Another definition of excellence in the UMass classroom that my scholarly work has taught me is when students, or faculty for that matter, move away from craving what you might call intellectual comfort food. This takes the form of accepting simple answers, a gravitation toward being right, a avoidance of paradoxes, and any expectation, really, of agreement on any level or in any form. Pop culture teaches us nothing if that. Our area of inquiry is a battlefield. Different interests hold sway at different times, and there is a constant tussle over both meaning and usage. I first noted how central this is to excellence in the classroom when a student came up to me after a whole class on American ethnic literature and said to me, "I knew what ethnicity meant much more before I took this class." And the student was expressing bemusement, and she was even more bemused when I hollered, "That's great!" I know well that it can be humbling. My last book taught me the same thing. And this is the book that is on the American Renaissance Festival, what I carried in thinking I was going out to find out would be wrong. I was sort of interested in this, like the use of European history in this way that's not particularly concerned with accuracy, but really matters to the people doing it. I had no idea that the first Renaissance Festival was organized and staged by blacklisted Hollywood Reds as a benefit for the country's first public radio station and was hiding Vietnam War resistors within a matter of years. So in fact, that book humbled me so well and truly, so very thoroughly that it might be my best book. And as my research brought me into conversation with crafters and artists, communally dwelling folk singers, Middle Eastern dancers, Swedish bagpipers, avant-garde mimes and puppeteers, seamsters and songsters and jokesters and jousters, I also learned I was right. At any university worth its salt, there is no definition capacious enough to do more than hint at excellence, but everyone is welcome to the conversation.
One more time to our colleagues. Let's give another round of applause. Want to thank everybody for coming out. Right next door, there's all kinds of wonderful food for us and a nice reception is planned. Thanks to everyone who had something to do with planning today. Let's go enjoy and enjoy our colleagues, okay? Thank you.